groups and stuff were kind of a new thing, I think, around that time. And so there was no kind of matrix to set yourself against or compare yourself with.
You know, every band seemed, through coincidence or through design, whatever, someone had a room or a rendezvous place, you'd meet up, and that became your headquarters.
You know, we were just all kids hanging out and kind of thrown together by this strange musical thing we were involved in. The Alex's Pie Stand thing was just where we all used to end up in the middle of the night coming back from a gig.
Alex's Pie Stand was an iconic place in Birmingham. It sounds daft, but it really was. It's now a car park and some advertising hoardings, and it's where the old Albany Hotel used to be. Wherever you'd been, whether you'd been, you know, in North Birmingham, if you say you've been working in Wolverhampton or something, or if you'd been in Worcester or in Birmingham itself, it was such a perfect place to meet up. You'd drive into Birmingham late at night, so around midnight, and there'd be all these group vans all parked up, and we'd all meet, and that's where the Move really started to be put together.
So that became a place where lots of deals were done, and lots of groups, you know, if somebody wanted to get somebody else in their group, that'd be like meeting them at Alex's or something, and deals would be done, various things like that.
And generally all the bands would just talk, you know, what songs you're doing these days, and which girls you're dating, and you know, whatever, and it'd all get, and the food was delicious. These were these fabulous fleur-de-lis pies, and you used to do great hot dogs, and that you couldn't have it, the only drink was hot, it was tea or coffee, and it was just a wonderful place to meet. And Johnny Prescott, the boxer who was very successful, British heavyweight champ, another Birmingham guy, loved his music. He used to go to Alex's Pie Stand, and we loved it when he was there, because he used to pay for everybody. Everything's on me, because you're making a few quid, you know.
I benefited out of the first, or one of the first kind of deals that were being done behind the scenes, in terms of when the Move were put together. Carl Wayne, who I didn't know at that time, but I knew later, but at that time he went around kind of getting all the best people out of the groups. He like got Roy Wood out of Mike Sheridan's group, Trevor Burton out of Danny King's group, Bev Bevan, was he in the Diplomats? I think he was, I'm not sure. Anyway, he got all these guys out of all these groups. It upset a lot of people doing it, you might imagine. But I benefited, because then Trevor left Danny King. Danny King heard a record that I'd made down the studio, phoned me up, said, "I want you in my band. I like this record you've made, and I want you in my band." So I was one of the ones who got pulled up to the next the next round, because these other guys had moved on to.
I didn't know at the time. It was David Bowie. I was chatting to, I think he was at the Cedar Club. He got talking to Ace Kefford and Trevor Burton, and said, "You know, there's what you should do," because they were two very young guys. Trevor was only 17, Ace was probably 18. Good-looking lads. He said, "You know what?" And David Bowie said, "What you should do is, there's all these bands in Birmingham. Just find the best people, and put a band that looks good and can really play, and get down to London, and you're never going to make it here in Birmingham. Get down to London and do something." And that, so they actually started it. And they asked Roy Wood first, because he was with Mike Sheridan and the Knight Riders, and really good player, good singer. And then it was me, and then it was Carl Wayne. We formed in late 65, and then 66 we started. Actually, put it together. Our first gig, and there's a little plaque actually on the wall. It was the Belfry, better known as a golf club now, but there used to be a regular Monday night gig at the Belfry, and the Move, that was our first ever show. And then that same night we went on to the Cedar Club in Birmingham, you know, it was a double header. And I met my wife the same night.
I saw them first at the Cedar. And they were just terrific, you know. I mean, Jeff Lynne was just knocked out with Roy and that, and he became friends with Roy. Jeff said to me, he's the best guitarist I've ever seen, you know, and I mean, we used to just be gobsmacked at the Move. They were just great.
I have to say, probably the best band I've ever been in was the original Move, because we were so keen and we could all play, and the energy level was incredible. So I think 66 and 67 were just brilliant.
Roy Wood was put on the map by the Move, which came out of Carl Wayne's vision for forming a supergroup. He was like an entrepreneur of the music scene, you know, in the way he put that group together and kind of he knew what he was aiming at, and it worked.
Tony Blackburn was going to play and launch Radio 1 with Flowers in the Rain because he liked the thunderstorm. We were driving back from somewhere way up in Scotland or somewhere, and we were actually still on the road at 7 in the morning coming back, and we pulled into a lay-by or a transport cafe or something to listen to our record being the first one on Radio 1. Then Ace Kefford had real problems. He took too much acid, actually. That didn't help. He took this great load of homemade acid, which is LSD, which is a really stupid thing to do. And he was a fragile character anyway, and that sort of turned him over the edge. And it became impossible to work with, you know, acid. Sacking basically, which was a shame. And then Trevor started to turn weird because we had our one and only number one, Blackberry Way, 69. We're literally number one, and Trevor says, I don't, I'm leaving. You know, so we'd finally got number one, and he left.
Trevor had left the Move. Danny had left the Moodies. Now they're both in with me, and it looked like fait accompli. I'm pretty sure that Tony Secunda had this agenda going. He looked at the individuals and he thought, he'll do. And he was looking to build a supergroup, of which I was a part, but he didn't consider the rest of the Uglies to be part of it. One by one, he gave them all the sack. Unfortunately, there was always conflict between Trevor and Denny because they both wanted to play lead guitar, and they decided that they would share the guitar and share the bass playing. So there was always going to be that clash there, and then we could never sort of settle on a drummer, and we auditioned lots of different guys, and we used to rehearse in a barn, but we always chose to rehearse about 3 o'clock in the morning. And you know, we'd get complaints from the local constabulary. It was never a smooth operation from the word go. It was fraught with difficulty. So never all getting up at the same time, all going to bed at different times. And there was a lot of stuff imbibed, and a lot of indulgence going on, and because there was an endless supply of revenue, because Tony Secunda had signed a management deal with an American film company, you know, on the promise of this supergroup. That kind of luxury, you would think there'd be nothing to prevent us, but it just didn't happen.
Nights in white satin, never reaching the end.
I've never understood why successful bands emerge from Birmingham in waves. Because when I arrived in the city in 71, it was the coming to the end of that amazing boom in through the 60s, where we'd seen Led Zepp and Black Sabbath and Move, Wizard, all hundreds of others. And then through the 70s, nothing. The only band that did any damage in the sort of mid-70s was Steve Gibbons Band.
And Gibbons had a Saturday lunchtime residency with his the perfect lineup for the Steve Gibbons Band. It was the thing that evolved out of the Uglies and Balls and things like that, and it had Dave Carroll and Bob Wilson as guitarists, Bob Lamb on drums, and I think it was Bob Boucher on bass, but they were several bass players, and it was a terrific band.
They would do that Saturday lunchtime, and then Saturday night they played the Railway on Curzon Street. I used to go to both. There was a bunch of us that used to go to both. And we knew all the songs and we sang along.
The main thing was we were building up a following, and alongside of that we were doing the Railway in Digbeth every Wednesday we did that. And then we started doing the Golden Eagle, and so, you know, we'd got ready-made fans, you see, so that was great. We supported probably one of the biggest, certainly one of the biggest bands in the world at the time, on a world tour. And then we started supporting lesser names like Ted Nugent, we supported ELO, we supported Bebop Deluxe, we supported Deep Purple. You know, obviously we had the big hits in 77. I don't really know why the band never sort of achieved the massive success that everyone was expecting.
And Bob Lamb, who's studio that's at it now, was the drummer in that band.
We were a great band, great live band, and we were sort of like local heroes in Birmingham, doing very well in America, and we made some terrible records, in my opinion. I mean, most of the albums that we made weren't up to par, as far as I'm concerned. I just didn't like it, I didn't like the recordings, I loved the band live.
Jeff Lynne, of course, forged the ELO, stamped his complete musical authority over the whole proceedings, and he's a great innovative and creative artist.
The move was really disintegrating, and we knew it, especially when Carl left. And Roy did bring his friend Jeff Lynne in from the Idol Race, but with the sole intention of starting a new band. Jeff Lynne was not interested in being in the move. He was very ambitious as well, incredibly talented, and he wanted to work with Roy more than anything else, and that's when they came up with this idea of Electric Light Orchestra.
He got plugged into the idea that he could actually do this. He had a belief that he could actually do this. I mean, I used to write songs, but I didn't quite have the same level of belief in it that he did. And he really went for it. You know, he worked real hard at it.
We're in a weird position because we got an album out with it. The first ELO album was released, but at the same time we got a massive hit with California Man. It was a lovely way to finish, though. You know, we had the Move's track record is very good. We released 12 singles and had 2 flops, and the other 10 were hits. And the last one was California Man, which is a massive hit, and a great song, actually. So it was good to finish on a high. And then the next hit single was 105.38 Overture, which Jeff wrote, and that was it was ELO's debut hit. The Move actually or our manager, Tony Segunda, made a huge mistake in the about 68.
Tony Segunda was a very successful manager. Prior to the movie, he'd had the Moody Blues, and he was involved with Procol Harum and White, A Shade of Pale.
The Move should have gone to America and should have made albums, and I think would have done very well, but we took the wrong direction. And I think with ELO, we were very aware of that. El Dorado was a gold album in America, didn't do anything in Britain, but that meant that was so... I've still got, the first gold album was such a, it was the best one of all, really, having that first gold album. And we, ELO, although we had loads of hit singles as well, but yeah, a new ELO album was an event. But albums just take a long time to make in those days. That was a big difference. That was a huge difference between ELO and The Move. It's a living thing. It's a It came as a great shock when Roy left, because myself and Jeff and Richard Tandy, we had no idea that Roy was not happy or anything. And we released the first album, which was a bit hit and miss, and there was some stuff worked and some didn't. But we did this tour of Italy, I remember, and then we came back, and then next thing we heard, it was literally a bit embarrassing, really. We heard off other people that Roy Wood has got this new band called Wizard, and. And he, it was like a rock and roll band. So we had to sort of regroup and bring in new players. And made ELO into a 7-piece band. And then actually started bringing in people that were not from Birmingham. But myself and Richard Tandy and Jeff Lynne were all Birmingham Boys.
Richard would always go to the stadium or whatever where we were playing 2 hours before anybody else, and he'd be in a room a bit like this room Saturday playing the piano when we got there practicing. Nobody else would. We'd all turn up 5 minutes before or whatever and off we go, but Richard was just so dedicated.